Welcome to Radio Paul's Radio Rants, broadcasting to you on Cox Channel 37, Comcast 27 in Reston, and around the world at fcac.org/radiofairfax. This is a weekly show that provides you the very best in alternative news and views with your host, Radio Paul.
You know I ain't no clown, 'cause these damn blue-collar tweakers, they're the backbone of this town.
Hey-ya, hey-ya, hey-ya.
Greg Palast is an investigative journalist who reports for the BBC and The Guardian, among others. You can read his reports at gregpalast.com. He's best known in the U.S., for uncovering the purge of black voters from Florida's voter rolls in 2000. Greg is also the author of the New York Times bestsellers The Best Democracy Money Can Buy and Armed Madhouse. His brand new book, which is already a New York Times bestseller, is called Billionaires and Ballot Bandits: How to Steal an Election in 9 Easy Steps, and he'll be spending the first half hour tonight talking about that very thing. Welcome to Radio Paul's Radio Rants, Greg.
Hey, glad to be with you.
Excellent. I want to just kind of jump right in here and talk about what's going on, because it is election time, and you made a prediction in your book that you think Obama is likely to lose the 2012 election, and I'm wondering, what are the 9 steps to steal this election in your book that you think could cause him the election?
Well, actually, it was in Billionaires and Ballot Bandits, I say, I quote the line, why Obama is likely to lose in 2012, is actually a statement by Karl Rove, who is the mastermind of the steal. He lays it out. Whether he'll succeed or not, I don't know, but he's not afraid to tell you how he intends to do it. There's 9 ways to steal the vote. And to him, he says it's real simple. What you have to do is make sure that there is a reduction of the black vote. You're not going to convince African Americans to vote against Obama and for a guy with who has a dressage horse in a car elevator. But the trick is to stop black people from voting and other Democrats. You know, I mean, it's not like Karl Rove doesn't like black people. He doesn't like the color of their vote, which is blue Democratic. Now, I don't care myself whether Obama gets elected or not. I do care as a journalist that whoever's inaugurated gets the most votes. And exposing the steal in Billionaires and Ballot Bandits is what I'm trying to accomplish.
Well, there's plenty of things to cover in the book. In fact, way too many to go over in a half hour. But it does kind of boil down to 2 elements here that I'm seeing, which is there's keeping people from voting, such as turning them away at the voting booths, but there's also this ugly thing, I guess I know it's called caging, where they go in and they try to remove people's rights to vote, get them off the voter rolls. And I just
it's very creepy.
It is creepy, and I just want to quote a couple things here and kind of have you jump in on that. In 2008 election, the book says that approximately 2,706,275 votes were cast but never counted. In California, 42% of registered Hispanic voters had their forms rejected. We have people disappearing from Democratic voter rolls. 29,000 disappeared in Iowa, 58,000 in Arizona, and now there's apparently less than 176,000 left in registered in Pennsylvania. What in the world is going on?
Well, there are fewer. Yeah, the Pennsylvania Democratic voting has dropped. Democratic registered has dropped. What's going on is a purge system. 22 million names were removed from the voter rolls in the last 2 years. That's not my number. That's from something called the U.S. Elections Assistance Commission, which tracks not only the votes, but the ballots that don't get counted. So we have what we have is a system where we have people that troll the voter rolls to challenge voters' right to vote. Now, if that were, if it were even on both parties, it wouldn't matter if it were even on racial or income lines, but it's no such thing. So one trick that's used, for example, is caging. Karl Rove, who set up, who now has something called Crossroads GPS, which, by the way, is even though it's called a PAC for Romney, in fact, it's a charity under the IRS code. But you know, the Supreme Court's allowing charities to spend money campaigns. They got $250,000. He's got a system called Data Trust, a big data mining operation. We've caught him previously, and I say we. I used to, before I wrote Billionaires and Ballot Bandits for Rolling Stone and for BBC TV, I was investigating these guys, and we got internal emails from the Rove operation explaining how they sent letters to voters at their registration addresses marking the envelopes do not forward. When the letters come back, which they call cage because they go literally into a physical cage. When a voter is caged, they then challenge the voter as voting from an illegal address, from a fake address. Well, it sounds good on the surface, but who were they sending the letters to? Well, they were sending the letters, for example, to students at black colleges in August when they're away on vacation. So they know the voter wouldn't be there. They're not fraudulent voters. You're allowed to go visit your parents in the summer. You're still a legal voter. The creepiest, I think, was sending the letters to military bases. We have hundreds of thousands of soldiers who are registered voters at their military base. Well, if it says do not forward and the soldier isn't there, where do you think that they are, Mr. Rove? So the Republican Party, despite wrapping itself in the flag, actually systematically was challenging the votes of active duty soldiers when they were overseas. I actually talked to one of the soldiers. He said, well, I voted. I said, what do you mean you voted? He said, well, I mailed in my ballot. You can mail in a ballot from Afghanistan or Germany, wherever. Well, he did mail in his ballot, but it got challenged. He didn't even know it. That's the evil of this. Most of the victims of vote theft don't even know that their vote's been stolen. That's the great evil of it. That's just one of the nine gimmicks.
I noticed, too, that votes by mail, absentees, tend to be a real target. I was reading stuff in your book about how proper postage is a reason they reject
it. Last election, 488,000 ballots were mailed in and never counted. The New York Times has had a story where actually they thought it was 10 times that high, but it's about 500,000 votes get mailed in and not counted. So you mail in your ballot, you think, oh, yeah, it gets counted. Really? How do you know? If some, you know, pimply guy with a BlackBerry has your name on a hit list and your ballot comes in, they'll look for ways to challenge it. You had the wrong size envelope. You had postage due. That's a big one. You signed one way on the outside and a different way on the inside. Use the return address, which is different from your registration address. You have a stray mark on the ballot. Or, in the case of my parents, they had a write-in candidate, but the vote wasn't counted because they didn't darken in the bubble next to the candidate's name. And by the way, it wasn't like a throwaway vote because it was a candidate that would have won as mayor of San Diego had they not thrown out all the ballots or the bubble wasn't marked in. I mean, it's just goofy stuff like that. And if it were random, it'd be okay, but it's not. You got professional hitmen who are basically wiping out voters and going after your vote, and that's ugly.
And I understand that it's as serious as if your name is John Edward Smith III, it's not a problem for you. But if your name is LaQuisha Jackson, you're going to be scrutinized. Is that essentially correct that this is really
based? There's a real racial smear to this. First of all, in places like the chance your ballot will spoil, that's the term that they use. In other words, you cast a vote and it doesn't get counted. The chance your vote will spoil is 900% higher if you're African American than if you're white. You're a target because they know how you're going to vote. The other is when for example, a lot of the ways that they use things in Florida. Back in 2000, I'm the guy that discovered how Katherine Harris knocked off thousands of black people off the voter rolls because she said that they were ex-cons who can't vote in Florida. And by the way, in almost every state, if you have a felony conviction, you can vote, so don't be discouraged, but not in Florida. The thing is, okay, if there are illegal voters on the voter rolls, number one, the first thing you should do is, by the way, arrest them. It's a crime. It's another crime. I don't think anyone should ever get away with voter fraud. But the reason they didn't arrest them is that it was fake. None of these people were none, and I don't mean some were innocent. I mean every single person on Katherine Harris's list of many thousands, Every single person was innocent. They had names, and the one effect of slavery is to have a lot of common names. So you had names, for example, and here's an actual example. Robert Moore. A guy named Robert Moore commits a crime. Now, how many black people in Florida do you think are named Robert Moore? Hundreds. They lose their vote. And not only Robert Moore, but I have an example. Bobby Moore lost her vote. Now, they had a computer algorithm that said, okay, Robert Moore is a criminal or has a conviction. Bobby Moore is some attempt, you know, we're going to put that down as an attempt as a nickname to get around to try to vote. But it was Mr. Robert Moore and Mrs. Bobby Moore, Mrs. B-O-B-B-I Bobby Moore. So, and how do I know that they're black? It says B-L-A next to their name. Every voter in Florida has their race next to their name. So they know who they're going after. They know that they're going after a black voter because it says so.
Well, talking about crimes with voter fraud, my question is, how much time did Kathleen Harris get? How many charges is Karl Rove facing right now? Seriously.
Well, you know, that's a really good question, because the introduction to the book and one of the chapters is written by Bobby Kennedy, whose father wrote the Voting Rights Act, and he's a law professor, and he says, look, these things are crimes. He said Karl Rove should be in jail. This is a crime. You can't target black people to eliminate their votes just as a way to, you know, win an election. It is a felony crime itself. Obviously, these people aren't in jail. Why? And a lot of it is one of the evil, evil things about, you know, election theft is that when you steal an election, you also steal the badges. You know, you steal the cops. You're stealing the police department to nail people. And now, of course, you got to get a lot of people to go along. In the case of that game of caging voters, there was you'll see in the book, in Billionaires and Ballot Bandits, I have a chapter, a couple chapters involving Captain David Iglesias. He was the federal prosecutor for New Mexico. He's a staunch Republican. And when Karl Rove and the Republican Party asked him to go as a federal prosecutor, go and hunt down people that were on these caged voters, he thought he was going after real criminals, you know, fraudulent voters. He said he went after 50 people running all over the mesas of New Mexico, and he said, you know, they're all innocent. And they, you know what Rove told him? He said, arrest someone anyway, just to make it look good. And he said, what? We're federal. I went, it's not the Soviet Union. I don't arrest people for nothing. He said, well, you can let them go. He said, I'm not arresting people. So they fired him. Bush, at Karl Rove's demand, fired this prosecutor for refusing to arrest innocent people. And the excuse that they gave was that he was absenteeism. He didn't show up for work, they said, as a federal prosecutor. Well, that's because Captain Iglesias was also, if you saw the film A Few Good Men, the guy that plays Tom Cruise, the guy that Tom Cruise plays is Captain Iglesias. And Iglesias is being a U.S. Navy prosecutor, was sent by Bush to conduct the war crimes trial in Bosnia. So, yes, while he was in Bosnia at the direction of his commander-in-chief, he wasn't in New Mexico. And that's the games that they play. So when he tried to blow the whistle, they just fired him. That's how it works, man.
Well, and then my question, okay, is that we don't have anybody going to prison for this that should be going to prison. What about that bastion of democracy, the free press? This is being reported every night, and they're doing their job. What's going on? How is this? How are they missing this?
I got to tell you, because they have their heads in their zippers. I mean, in fact, I won't say what network. A big network was supposed to have me finally. An American network was supposed to have me on tomorrow morning. But I just got called. Forget it, because they're doing a story on, you know, Sandusky and the and playing with little boys, because sex will always beat information, you know. And so that's how it works. You get infotainment. There's no news. There's no real investigative reporting in America. I do these reports for BBC Television England and the Guardian newspapers. And yes, and Bobby Kennedy and I did a story for Rolling Stone, but you're not going to get this stuff on the nightly news. And that's, in a way, why I had to write Billionaires and Ballot Bandits, because the only way I could get this stuff out there is write a book. And by the way, I don't want people to forget that in the middle of it is a great comic book, a 50-page comic book by Ted Rawlins. And who's also a great reporter. So it's an investigative comic book about election heist. And again, it's not partisan. In fact, Rawl really does not like Mr. Obama very much, but that's okay with me. I don't care. I don't have an opinion myself, or I have opinions, but I don't express any partisan opinion ever. I'm off that. I don't have to worry about that. But so we have a comic book. We have some real investigative reporting, which is a lot of fun.
Yeah,
but I can't get it into the U.S. press.
Yeah, you and Noam Chomsky and all the other intellectuals in this country just seem to be ignored, which is just mind-boggling. And if six sells, maybe one of you can impress on them that the government is screwing us constantly. So maybe
yeah,
that.
But yeah.
I'm sorry. Maybe that would sell.
Well, you know, the thing is that the book is Billionaires and Ballot Bandits, and one of the things that the billionaires are very good at is controlling media. It's the first thing that they buy. First thing that they control. One of Bush's, not Bush, I say Bush, he's, well, he's playing out on his golf carts on his ranch because he's afraid of horses. That was one of my stories, by the way. I figured out the guy was afraid of horses. One of my favorite investigations. But the main thing is that Romney's big backer is a guy named Paul the Vulture Singer, and I didn't name him the Vulture. The Vulture is what his bankers call him because he basically picks at dying industries and dying nations. He's a pretty creepy guy, and he's the number one fundraiser. But he's very, for Romney, the important thing is that he knows how to control media coverage. I mean, this guy gets played as a wonderful guy, because in New York press, because he's for gay marriage, his son married a guy, so he's for gay marriage. So they say, well, he must be a wonderful guy then, ignoring the fact that he made $1 billion by his first billion by refusing to pay. He owned the asbestos company, Johns Manville. Thousands of their workers died from asbestos. The company withheld the information that the product was killing them. He figured out a way to not pay these workers who were dying, to not pay their medical bills. And he put that money in his pocket. Really nice guy, huh? But he's able to cover that up because he just buys up the press. You know, that's how it works.
There's a lot of that going on. And in a moment, I want to talk about the Koch brothers. You cover them in your book. Mm-hmm. But before I do that, though, a lot of these tactics that you're talking about in this book on national elections are also seem to be filtering down to local elections. In fact, there's a great example in your book about what was going on in Wisconsin with the recall. And I was wondering if you could talk about that for a second.
Yeah, in fact, I have to say that all vote theft is local. Just like all politics is local, so is all vote theft. In fact, the 2012 election is going to be the first time I've actually seen a systematic push for national. There's a national theft operation going on. I mean, Rove, the Koch brothers, for example. Since you mentioned them, I will bring them up right away because we need to. The Koch brothers have a data mining system called Themis, and they combine that with the Rove data trust machine. And they are going, especially in swing states, figuring out where to, where to hit these voter rolls, calling someone a felon, calling you an inactive voter, that's a new good one, fraudulent address, whatever they can come up with, and they go to friendly secretaries of state who run the voter list, and they purge your name. You may not even know until you show up on election day, which is why, by the way, I tell you one thing is, in Billionaires and Ballot Bandits, at the end of it, there is it's called Seven Ways to Beat the Ballot Bandits, and I call it my ballot condom for safe voting because it tells you how to protect yourself. And one thing is, my good friends, you think you're registered, think again. With all these names purged, it could be you. Check your registration now online at your state Secretary of State website. And so it's national, it's ugly, but most of it is most of it starts local. With the county, with all these local races. And in Wisconsin, the Kochs had a little system where they sent Democratic, likely absentee Democratic voters who own guns, which in their databases they cross matches. So they say likely Democratic voter, likely absentee voter, gun owner. They sent a note from a group called United Sportsmen of Wisconsin, created by the head of Koch's operation, a group that existed and then disappeared in 3 weeks. But what the group did was said, hey, fellow sportsmen, if you want to protect your gun rights, vote in, make sure that you send in your absentee ballot to request to this address and mail in your ballot here by this date. The addresses were fake, and the date was too late to have your vote counted. So in other words, they sent out letters to Democrats under this fake name, United Sportsmen of Wisconsin, to get them to lose their absentee ballot. You know, you'll mail it in, it's too late, or you ask for it from the wrong address and it doesn't arrive in time, and you're out of luck, buddy. So that's the type of creepy stuff that is happening. And they're doing it systematically, state by state. The big prize, by the way, is not the presidency. The big prize that they're moving for is the control of the Senate.
Well, Greg, okay, nobody's going to prison. The free press isn't blowing the whistle. But I know we can count on the Democratic Party and Barack Obama to be beating the war drums over this, right?
Let's remember how Barack Obama started his career, okay? He wasn't elected to the state Senate of Illinois. He went in and disenfranchised a couple thousand black people and had their signatures disqualified to get his opponent on the ballot. The incumbent state senator knocked her off the ballot by disenfranchising a couple thousand black people. So there's no one who's better at this than Obama. He's really good. And so that's how he got kind of elected, because there was no one else on the ballot. So the problem, the point I'm making is that the Democrats, unfortunately, are up to their elbows in the mud too. The problem is is that they're not as good at it. That's number one. But the bigger problem is that both Democrats and Republicans go after the same people. They go after voters of color, poor people. Like I said, Obama disenfranchised black people. Obama then moved to the Gold Coast district, the ultra rich. Penny Pritzker, his billionaire backer, Jamie Dimon, the head of J.P. Morgan. He ended up representing those people, having his district redrawn. But when he was going after disenfranchising voters, he wasn't taking away any votes from a country club. It was all poor voters. In New Mexico, the reason that there is a Republican governor, which is nuts in a state that's all Democratic and mostly majority Hispanic population, citizen Hispanic, they've been there longer than America's been there, is that the Hispanic Democrats have been disenfranchising, purging, and blocking the votes of other Hispanic Democrats as they fight over control of the party. And it's always the poor who get shafted. So don't look to the Democratic Party, because they do it too, and they're not going to stop the system. The incumbents were elected by this dirty system, and they're not going to clean it up. We're going to have to clean it up.
And we're going to cover that towards the end of you being here, how we need to do that. But at this point, we've kind of covered the fact that nobody's going to prison, the free press isn't covering the issue, and the Democrats just are not in the game to expose it. But there's some bigger players than Karl Rove. In fact, Karl Rove can arguably be said to be working for the likes of the Koch brothers, and you talk about this guy in your book also called the Iceman.
And the Iceman, the Iceman is really Rove's employer, because he wrote the big checks. There's Singer the Vulture, and there's the Iceman. I didn't call him the Iceman. He's known by his bankers as the Iceman because he's considered a cold-blooded vulture capitalist. And he's another guy who profits from death and destruction. And I'm not making, I'm not being over dramatic. If you look at the first pages of Billionaires and Ballot Bans, opens up with a meeting between the Iceman and Rove, where he writes a check for $20 million to Rove. By the way, that check is he's adding in another $50 million. One guy spending $70 million, but it's nothing to this guy. He's worth over $10 billion. So for him to spend $70 million is, saying, now let's just go to McDonald's, And so it's what does the Iceman want? Because the Iceman, by the way, is libertarian. He doesn't have a problem with gay marriage or abortion rights, any of that stuff. This doesn't mean anything to him. It's all about the money. He's not even a Republican. All he cares about are two things. He's got to get rid of the Environmental Protection Agency because they're in the way of two things. Number one, his new business, which is to create the largest waste nuclear waste dump in America. And, you know, he expects to crank a lot of money from that. And the Environmental Protection Agency says you can't put it on top of a water aquifer, you know, which is like, no kidding. So he says he's willing to spend $70 million to eliminate the EPA, which is cheap for him. He'll make billions. Then the other thing is he owns National, he was the owner, I guess still is the main owner of National Lead, which is renamed NL, but it's still just as poisonous. NL has been poisoning people for decades with lead in paint in particular. And schools are covered with Dutch Boy white paint, which is filled with lead, and it has to be removed, or kids are going to literally. We have, you know, thousands of cases of mental retardation because of lead paint, and you don't want it in the schools. He has successfully resisted taking the lead paint out of schools because that would cost him about $1 billion, and that's a tenth of his cash. And he ain't gonna. He doesn't care how many kids get poisoned, you know. And he needs someone in the Senate and someone in the White House to make sure that he can keep poisoning without paying the price.
I'm starting to think that there's some of that Dutch paint in the White House too.
Okay.
Speaking of the insensitivity of these multi-billionaire bandits, the Koch brothers, as I understand from the book, are a combined worth of about $40 billion. And there's an incident there is just mind-boggling with one of them trying to get $3 out of a little old lady. And I was wondering if you could talk about that in the quotation of what one of the Koch brothers said when somebody challenged him on this.
Right. There are actually four Koch brothers, so together they're worth about $50 billion. David and Charles are worth $40 billion together. In Billionaires and Ballot Bandits, I have a couple chapters on the Kochs on stuff that you've probably never heard about them. I was investigating the Koch brothers 15 years ago, before as a journalist, and I was working in coordination with the FBI, and there was oil being stolen by the Koch oil trucks from the Osage Indian Reservation, maybe about $30 worth of oil a week from each Native American family there. They lived the poor people, you know. Just a little skim. And so we followed the trucks back, and we go back to, and you know, and what do you find? You find, if you followed the trucks back, went back to loading dock in Oklahoma, and standing on a loading dock is a big, tall, white guy who's telling these truckers to steal more. And it was Charles Koch. Because I thought, maybe it's just some low-level guy. No, it's Koch himself, Charles Koch, telling these guys to steal more. Now, what was weird about it is Koch was already, this is back in early 90s, Koch was already a billionaire. He'd inherited it from his daddy, right? So his senior vice president asked him why. Now, I know he asked him why because his vice president was wired. So we have a transcript. And his vice president asked Charles Koch, why, you know, basically, you're a billionaire. Why do you want $30 from some Indian lady? And Koch said, and this is the front of Billionaires and Ballot Bandits in big letters. Koch said, I want my fair share, and that's all of it. Nice guys.
Yeah, apparently they think their fair share includes our votes, too.
Yeah, all of it definitely includes the vote, because obviously you can't do that stuff. And don't forget, by the way, that was a federal crime. You can't just steal oil from you're stealing oil. When you steal oil from a reservation, you're stealing. It's obviously theft, grand theft. You add it up. It's grand theft, but it's also racketeering, and it's also theft of U.S. property, because the U.S. government owns part of that oil. And so Koch faced an indictment. In fact, I have a copy of the indictment in Billionaires and Ballot Bandits against Charles Koch, who's called, by the way, Target 67C, but I'm telling you it's Koch, and he won't deny it. He can't deny it. Target 67C is Charles Koch. And there's an indictment there. It does say Koch Industries, because his company would also be indicted. So that's printed on there. But why was he just, you know, you asked me before, why isn't he in jail? I mean, we have, the FBI has tapes of this guy stealing, you know, bragging about stealing. We have the tapes of the theft. We have the witnesses. We have the oil. We have the truckers. I mean, this is a closed case. Straight up theft, you know, just like, you know, pictures of the bank robber, fingerprints, you know, there it is. What happened was the indictment was brought by a federal prosecutor in Oklahoma. The Koch brothers owned the senator, Nichols, and they owned the Senate majority leader, a guy named Bob Dole, and they had the prosecutor fired. So the federal prosecutor was fired, replaced by one of Koch's cronies, who then not only dropped the indictment, but shut down the grand jury, which was already impaneled, without showing them any evidence, and then wrote Koch a letter saying, we're not indicting you, which is unusual. You don't write a letter saying, we're not indicting you, you know, but that's the, it's like a get out of jail free card. But that's what happened with the Kochs. They literally bought their way out of a criminal indictment. Huh. And that's what keeps, and throughout the book, throughout Billionaires and Ballot Bandits, you will see the Kochs continually buying themselves out of prison. They keep buying that get out of jail free card every time they break a law.
In the few minutes we have left, Greg, I'd like you to talk about, since the fact that our government isn't prosecuting, the press isn't doing their jobs, and the Democrats aren't standing up, and these guys can buy themselves out of just about anything, what is it that we need to do? What are our seven steps that we as citizens have to step up to the plate and do to start getting this voting situation straightened out?
Well, the first thing is we don't let them discourage us. We've had lots of movements which have been successful, the populist movement, the environmental movement, the women's suffrage movement, abolitionist movement, and the United States of America is itself a suffrage movement. When we said we want the vote, we don't want the World Trade Organization, then called the British Empire, to run us. Now, how do we get it back? We have to protect our own vote and those around us. That's why I say go to Billionaires and Ballot Bandits. At the back is a tear out, 7 ways to beat the ballot bandits. And you spread that around, you act on it. It is, they call it, you know, again, I call it the ballot condom for safe voting. And you do such simple things as you don't mail in your vote. I just told you that they throw out your ballot. You know, if you can avoid the mail-in, avoid it. Bring in your ballot. You can usually actually bring in a paper ballot. Bring in your absentee ballot if you have one. Second, don't wait for election day to so-called election day. Vote early, because if your name has been purged, you're called inactive. Like my own assistant, who actually drew, you know, the guy that actually created the poster, the 7 ways to beat the ballot bandits, he lost his vote because he was considered, they marked him in New York as inactive. As I say, I mean, how do they know he wasn't doing sit-ups? What do you mean inactive? But because he waited for election day, he was out of luck. Vote early, like in many states, like right now. And so if there's a problem, you can fix it. You know, things like don't accept these so-called provisional ballots. They're bogus. They're placebo ballots. Demand a real ballot. Demand, you know, you're going to have to argue for that. Other things you can do, but the other one of the things I say, and can't give you all 7, you don't have time, go to ballotbandits.org, ballotbandits.org, or gregpalast.com, and flip over to there. And you can download the 7 ways to beat the ballot bandits, a nice poster or leaflet, whatever you want. But one of the big things is, you know, I call it the Occupy Ohio, Invade Nevada. You have to get active. You have to take, you know, get out there, register voters, help people on election day, make sure people are voting. If we have better voters, we're going to end up with better candidates. Don't moan about the fact that we don't have good choices. We get better voters if they don't bleach those voter rolls white, if they don't get rid of students and progressives, if they don't, you know, if they don't load it up with the billionaires' choices for voters, we won't end up with the billionaires' choices as candidates. So it's a process, and that's what we have to do. We have to take charge of this. And finally, number 7, by the way, is demand that the votes be counted. You know, none of this Al Gore stuff of going to the mat. You know, Al Gore, the election was stolen in his face. He knew about it. In fact, he even knew before the Supreme Court acted about the purge of black voters. But Gore hates me and didn't want to rely on our findings for BBC, and he was ready to go to the mat. He's fine. He's worth over $100 million right now. He got taken care of. Don't worry about him. We have to worry about us. Yeah.
Very good. Ladies and gentlemen, that is Greg Palast, author of Billionaires and Ballot Bandits, How to Steal an Election in 9 Easy Steps. I invite you to visit gregpalast.com and make sure you pick up this book. It's got really great chapters in it, such as Block the Vote, Aliens Attack, The Ex-Con Con Job, Apple Pie Apartheid, Christians, Cannibals, and Diamonds, all about Pat Robertson. And, you know, ladies and gentlemen, when we come back from our break, we're going to have on hip revolutionary poet Alan Barish about a piece called Mr. Magoo Goes to Hell, where Mr. Magoo basically drives right-wingers nuts in hell. Greg, it's been a pleasure to having you on.
It really was a pleasure for me, too. Thanks a lot.
All right, thank you.
Bye. Something in
your smile. We're going to be doing a bit here from Alan Barish called Mr. Magoo Goes to Hell. Yes, Mr. Barish will be a future guest on this show. I'll be looking for your feedback as to what you think about it.
Was sent straight to hell. Somehow, the Book of Life recorded all the accidental hell that Mr. Magoo had rained down upon the world as acts of wanton cruelty. As punishment for these acts, poor Magoo was sent straight to hell. Now, mind you, this hell that we're talking about is not the same old hell that your good book tells you. No, since the death of Henry Ford, hell has become quite different. It's kind of like Paterson, New Jersey during the Depression, or Lordstown, Ohio, that auto plant that was called the fastest assembly line in the world. Now, when you were sent to hell, you went by Hellhound, the official one-way bus line of Satan. That's where it all started for Magoo. He waited in the purgatory bus station where the announcer on the unseen microphone said, "The 441 express bus to hell has been delayed on the New Jersey Turnpike. There's a 20-year delay. We appreciate your patience and thank you for going Hellhound." All the other passengers who were going to hell seemed more than a little upset. They milled around smoking cigarettes and cursing. "Damn," said a young chemist who had been developing the HIV virus at Fort Detrick. "When I get to hell, I'm gonna call Satan and give him a piece of my mind. Who in hell does he think he is? I've got deadlines to meet. I want to see my handiwork firsthand." "That fella don't know who he's f***ing with," said a former Green Beret who was an instructor at the School for the Americas, where he gave instructions on what was called advanced prisoner interrogation to cops from Peru. "I got lost souls to interrogate, and interrogation squads to organize. There's no time to lose. The commies could be plotting a revolt in hell as we speak." Magoo, on the other hand, was delighted. "Oh, goody," he explained. "That will give me some more time to get some more film. I guess I'll have another donut and coffee and use the John. I just love bus trips, don't you?" He walked over to the coffee shop, stepping on the toes of a man who had made millions bilking people in real estate scams. "Sorry," he said, and turned away. He jauntily tossed his umbrella on his shoulder, nearly poking out the eye of a woman who wrote propaganda for the CIA. The bus finally arrived. It looked as if it hadn't been washed in centuries. It was already full. The new arrivals had to stand in the aisle. The bus inside smelled like beer, vomit, and cat urine. "Lucky I brought this bleach-scented incense," said Magoo. He lit a stick. The smoldering match fell into the hat of a televangelist preacher who had run a string of kiddie porn film studios. It smoldered a while in his toupee before catching fire. Magoo slapped him silly, putting out the flames. When they were finally out, the man had lost consciousness. There was a gaping hole in his hairpiece, and the bus smelled like bleach and burnt plastic. All the way down, Magoo snapped pictures and talked nonstop about how his nephews were going to love the snapshots he was taking. 100 years later, the bus pulled up to the Hell bus stop. Everyone was glad to be leaving Magoo. "That man made my life a living hell," said a slumlord from Harlem. "I couldn't agree with you more," replied an aide to the Dalai Lama. Magoo paid no one notice of this. He went straight to a telephone booth and found the yellow pages. He looked a little bewildered for a second when he realized the directory was made entirely of asbestos paper. He looked up hotels. He found a hotel where he thought he had a reservation, the Hell Hyatt. When he arrived at his destination, he managed to walk to the check-in counter and step on every bellhop shoes in the place. He banged the bell so vigorously that it fell to pieces in his hands. In the back room, Satan heard the racket and came out at once. When he saw Magoo, he realized something was seriously wrong. He looked at the reservation list and back at Magoo. He tried to hide his embarrassment. Magoo's name was not on his list. He knew if he took Magoo, he could be fined for taking an unauthorized soul. He also knew it might be a century or two before he could complete the paperwork required to send Magoo back up north. He knew if he had to take care of the paperwork that he'd have to do to get Magoo out of hell, he'd have to work the entire weekend. That would mean the golf date with Ollie North this weekend was canceled. He lit a cigarette and walked to the counter. "Hi," he said, "I'm Louis Cipher. I'm the manager of the Hell Hyatt. You are the famous Mr. Magoo?" Magoo nodded and tipped his hat. Without waiting for Magoo to speak, Satan went on speaking. "Mr. Magoo, we seem to have a problem. It seems somehow the big computer made a real foul up. You aren't supposed to be in hell. As a matter of fact, you aren't supposed to be dead at all. I think you're supposed to be living a while longer in reruns on some nostalgia channel on cable TV. So here's the deal. We have a hospitality suite for accidents like you. Would you mind staying there at no charge to you while I make all the preparations? It might take a century or two. However, I will work as fast as I can to get you back to the living, or at least set up north." Magoo, not realizing he was in hell, was furious. "Mr. Cipher," he said, and pounded his fist and knocked down the counter, "I paid good money to take this trip to Miami. If you are thinking of sending me back because of your errors, I want a full refund. I am very upset. Let me tell you, when I get home, I'm going to write the Better Business Bureau about your lousy outfit." Satan, still trying to be gracious, realized Magoo didn't know where he was. He politely excused himself and went back to his back room. He picked up the White Princess telephone that was the hotline for emergencies like this. When the party on the other line answered, Satan started yelling, "Look, I don't care who goofed on this. I've got Mr. Magoo down here. I used to watch him on TV. He was funny then. Now that he's down here, my life could be a living hell. I want him out of here. I'll give St. Peter a special clearance to come and get him right now." "Cool it, buddy," said a voice on the other end. "I gotta clear it with my boss. I'll have to put you on hold." 10 minutes later, the voice on the other line said, "Boss says he can live with your request. Pete will be down in an hour. He's driving a 57 Chevy with California plates. Better call your people and make the arrangements." "Okay," replied Satan. He thanked the other party profusely. He hung up the phone and made all the arrangements. He quickly walked to the lobby to tell Magoo what was going on. The lobby was a shambles. Curtains were torn down. People were rubbing their toes where Magoo had stepped on them. Two Pentagon generals were nursing eye wounds where Magoo's umbrella had poked them. Magoo was oblivious to all this. He was sitting in Joe Scheidler's lap, totally unaware of the man underneath him. He loudly slurped a bowl of cold vichyssoise soup intended for Scheidler. He saw Satan coming and yelled out, "Louie! Louie! Where's that slow-ass molasses waiter? Tell him to come back and get this soup. It's cold as ice. Where's my London broil? I ordered it hours ago. Where in hell's that bellboy? Just then, a frazzled waiter appeared. Magoo handed the bowl of soup to him. Take this back and heat it up real good, he said. He handed the bowl to the waiter, spilling half of it down Joe Scheidler's crotch. Joe Scheidler winced, thinking of the dry cleaning bill he'd have to pay. Then Magoo saw the plate of food the waiter had had for him. He snatched the plate off the tray, spilling brown gravy on Scheidler's pants leg. The gravy was hot. It burned Scheidler's leg. As Satan patiently explained the mistake, Magoo wolfed down his food. Crumbs and gravy flew everywhere, staining Satan's and Scheidler's clothes. By the time Magoo had finished his dessert of baked Alaska, Satan had finally made Magoo realize what was going on. So I'm not in Miami? Asked Magoo. I'm really in hell, and I really don't belong here? And you have to refund me in cash, and St. Peter's going to take me to my hotel? Fine, fine. Hand me my money. Satan handed a red envelope to Magoo. Magoo counted the money twice. It was all there. Magoo turned to Satan. Louis, he said, since this was your fault, I assume the meal's on the house. Satan bowed and smiled like a choir boy. Yes, Magoo. It's on the house. Just then, the bellhop announced that St. Peter was waiting for Magoo. Magoo turned to Satan. I've got to go now, Louie, he said, and rose out of his seat so quickly, Scheidler fell back on the floor. Magoo was totally oblivious to this and stood with both feet on the deceased's anti-abortionists. He shook Satan's hand, turned around, stepped on Scheidler's face, and walked toward the car. As St. Peter drove off, Satan lit up a cigarette and said, thank God he's gone. It would have been hell round here for me, and I'm the boss. Alternate ending. As soon as Magoo got off the bus, two demons tried to figure out whether Magoo was here for punishment or eternal employment. They walked up to Magoo. We need to see your passport, said a blonde-haired demon. Magoo just looked at them in a puzzled way. I didn't bring any literature with me. I was reading in the library when I fell asleep. The last book I have is at home. Don't play games with us, said the demon. Where's your passport? I didn't get one, replied Magoo. Then you're not here for eternal damnation? Asked the blonde-haired demon. No, indeed, replied Magoo. I'm here to do some work. They're making a feature-length cartoon here in Miami about me. Since the demons were former members of Operation Rescue, they were used to following orders and not thinking. If a new arrival didn't have a passbook, they were an employee. When Magoo told him why he was in hell, it didn't matter to them what else he said. He was an employee of Satan. He was to be shown the employee's entrance in hell, sent to the Hell Hilton until he finished his orientation sentences. Then he was to be given his job assignment and an apartment. That's all these demons knew. They pointed Magoo to a door which said, Employees Only. Magoo walked through to a cab stand. A demon in a yellow cab pulled up and took Magoo to his hotel. When Magoo arrived, he slammed the car door so hard it fell off its hinges. Stepping on every bellhop's foot in the lobby, he made his way to the check-in counter. He lightly tapped the bell, which broke in half at his touch, while the marble top of the counter slid off, pinning the day clerk against the little shelf of tiny cubicles that held guests' keys and mail. In the back room, Satan was meeting with the hotel manager. They were going over some last-minute details about the upcoming orientation session and the Rush to Hell tour that was scheduled on the arrival of Mr. Limbaugh after he was to choke to death on some breaded pork chop bristle. When Satan heard the noise, he ran to see what was going on. He saw Magoo standing by the complimentary hot hors d'oeuvres bar in the lobby, showering guests with crumbs. He turned white as a ghost. My God in heaven, he thought. My God in heaven, it's Mr. Magoo. He's never done one intentional bad thing in his life. Somehow, the big computer fouled up again. Satan knew what this meant for him. There was an unauthorized soul in hell. This would mean he could be fined millions for every day Magoo was in hell through no fault of his own. That was how the contract stated it. He watched in fear as Magoo grabbed a bottle of champagne, popped the cork, and sent it flying through space to totally destroy a fine crystal chandelier hanging in the center of the lobby. It crashed to the floor on top of Joseph Mengele in his wheelchair. Satan went back to the office. He grabbed one of the white princess phones he had meticulously placed in various locations in hell for occasions like this. The voice on the other end of the recording said,
"You have reached the Heaven Can't Wait emergency hotline. To serve you better, all calls are monitored. Please let us know if this is an inconvenience to you. To find out about our Hertz rent-a-car, press 1. For housing, press 2. To speak with God or one of his representatives, press 3.
Satan pressed 3. The same voice said,
"You have reached the offices of our Lord God, Allah, Jah, Jehovah, Yahweh, and Son. All lines are busy. If you know your party's extension, you may dial it now. Otherwise, please hold and someone will be with you shortly."
Satan's blood pressure rose. The knuckles on his hand gripping the telephone receiver turned white. If Satan was angry before, he was really mad now. If there was one thing he hated in creation, it was being put on hold or given the runaround on voicemail. Satan hated dealing with voicemail. He thought to himself, if God's so damn good and can do anything, why do I have to deal with voicemail? A voice from out of nowhere said, "I have voicemail so that I don't have to fuck with assholes like you until I'm good and ready to. So use the voicemail, Louis. You know the drill." Satan hated being one-upped by God, but he reluctantly pressed a number. A voice said, "You have reached God Almighty. I can't come to the phone right now. At the tone, please leave a message that includes your name, telephone number, and the time you called. I'll get back to you as soon as I can." Satan spoke quickly. "God help me, I've got Mr. Magoo down here in hell. I enjoyed watching him on TV, but seeing him live and in the flesh is pure hell for me. And the one thing I do best down here is torturing people. I'm the one that tortures people." There was a beep, and the original voice gave some more explanation. Satan followed them until he got Jah. Frantically, Satan explained the problem. Jah inhaled deeply on the joint of good interplanetary herb and handed it back to Peter Tosh. After he exhaled, he said to Satan, "No problem, man. I'll get Jack Kerouac to ride down and pick up this Magoo fella in half an hour. Just clear it with your people. Last time I brought up an unauthorized soul, it was centuries before we could get through the red tape, man." Satan agreed and hung up the telephone and made the call to take care of any problems. He then turned and walked out to the lobby. The lobby was a shambles. It looked as if a squad of drunken fraternity boys with hatchets had descended upon hell. The curtains were torn down, food was everywhere. Guests and employees were nursing various wounds. In the corner was Magoo. That was the only place that was unharmed. He was sitting in the lap of the late Randall Terry, who had suffered a heart attack when he found out one of his adopted children had joined Refuse and Resist. Magoo was totally oblivious to Terry and was eating baked Alaska and dribbling it down the legs of Randall Terry. Magoo leaned back in the chair, his back slammed tight against Terry's mouth. Terry let out a moan of protest. "Isn't that sweet," said Magoo. "It's a musical chair, and it's playing that lovely music of Brian Eno. I think it's called Music for Hotels. I love that New Age music." Satan approached him, grinning like a choir boy. "Mr. Magoo," he said humbly, "I am Louis Cipher. I run this place. I am the man responsible for what goes on here. There's been a terrible mistake. You're not supposed to be here." Magoo looked at Satan, trying not to look hurt. He choked back his tears and said, "They don't want me for the part. They haven't got Jim Backus to play me, have they?" "No, Mr. Magoo," said Satan, feeling a little pity for the man and realizing Magoo didn't know he was in hell. "No, Mr. Magoo, you're on the wrong set, that's all." Magoo looked around and a puzzled look came on his face. "Where in hell am I?" "You're in the Hell Hilton." "Oh, in that case, I guess I won't get any ice water." Satan was about to reply that he could get him some when Jack Kerouac came in. When Jack saw Magoo, he smiled. "It's you, Magoo, baby. Mr. Magoo in the flesh. Come on with me, Pops. Let's split this hot-ass joint." "I'm right behind you," said Sonny as he stepped on a dozen guests' toes and walked toward the door. Kerouac opened the door to the red Ford Escort. When Magoo was inside, he opened up the driver's seat and got in, closed the door, turned the ignition, and took off like an escaping bat. Magoo turned the radio on. It was playing a song by the Animals called "We Gotta Get Out of This Place." A mile or two later, Kerouac turned on the air conditioning. When Satan finally could not see the car anymore, he turned and walked to the bar. He ordered a gin and tonic. He sipped his drink and smoked his cigarette and thought to himself, "Thank God Magoo's gone. That man made light hell for me, and I'm the only one authorized to do that around here. After all, I'm the boss."